Hi everyone, welcome back to Book Banter from the Public Library of Youngstown and Mahoning County. I'm Sarah here with Amy.
Hi.
And this week we are going to discuss What Big Teeth by Rose Szabo. So Amy, why don't you tell us what it was about?
Okay, so this book follows Eleanor and her family. When she was quite young, she was sent off to boarding school and she doesn't quite understand why. And so several years go by without really any contact with her family, and she abruptly leaves after she does something. And it is her journey home, and she realizes that her family doesn't trust her, and there's some paranormal elements as well of maybe who her family is, because the village that they live in are quite weary of her family. And so Sarah and I read this book and we had to do our thumbs up or thumbs down. Sarah, are you ready?
I'm ready.
Okay. 3, 2, 1.
Yeah. Ah! See, I would give it a solid 1 thumb up. I liked it. And I know I've said this before. I liked it. I didn't love it, mm-hmm. but I liked it. I did have some issues, but I liked it.
Yeah. Let's talk about it.
Okay. Well, I think the thing that really keeps me solidly in the like it category, I guess, is that I loved the super creepy mood throughout the whole thing.
Yes.
Like, it is just amazingly creepy. And even when you're approaching the climax, and even at the end of the book, once you've had the resolution, there's still a super creepy vibe happening.
Yeah, the setting and the tone is very, like, eerie. You know, the family house is, I mean, I could just picture the paintings on the wall of all the family members and just the coldness of it. So yeah, it was very atmospheric for sure.
Yeah, I think what I wrote down in my notes was I called it low-key horror. There's not a lot of violence that's not gruesome. It's like spooky, but not really scary. It's a very plot and character-driven kind of low-key horror.
Yeah, definitely. Because there is this element, the supernatural paranormal element. And I didn't want to say too much in the summary because we really, there's not words to describe who these people are. We can find some terms that sort of relate to them. We could say, oh, it's zombie-esque or werewolf-esque. But I feel like they have their own rules in this book.
Yeah, it's you know, it kind of reminded me a little bit of The Walking Dead, where they build this whole show and then they never actually say the word zombies.
Right.
You know, and so, yeah, I mean, even though some of the characters, some of Eleanor's family members, we know what they are, but they never actually say the word explicitly.
Correct. Yeah. And I liked that. You know, I think a lot of times we get like hung up on, oh, like vampires can't go out in the, you know, daytime, or, you know, they don't like garlic. And so like to just kind of like wipe that slate clean and say, okay, these are certain creatures, but you may not know exactly what they are.
Yeah. And that makes it fun too, because you don't know exactly what their abilities are.
Correct.
You know, because you do have that little bit of unknown. I will say, it go kind of along that lines, one of the issues I had was that I felt like that whole, like, what am I reading? What's going to happen? Where is this going? Like, that feeling just kind of went on a little bit too long for me.
I felt like it never ended. And that was one of my cons for sure, is I wanted some answers. I didn't need all the answers. And I understand that some things couldn't be answered. But I felt like you said, we were too in the dark for way too long. And I don't ever think we ever got to the light. Like, we ended the book and there were still so many questions.
There were. I mean, this is definitely open to be continued in other books. But yeah, there was just a little too much of, too many little open ends, too many little details that I wanted to know more about that weren't really ever addressed again.
Yeah, I understand.
Yeah, now swinging back the other way, because that's how I was. I was constantly like swinging back this book. Going with the characters, like, I ended up really liking Arthur just as a character and his story and his background and everything about it. I really liked it.
And I think that is so intentional on the author's part. Like, mm-hmm. He was such an interesting character. And while I felt like the same with you, he was the most entertaining character, I felt like a little lackluster with the character development, especially with our main character, Eleanor. I feel like we didn't learn as much about her as I would have hoped and would have gotten into her head as much as I think we should have.
Yeah. Speaking of characters, I did not like Grandmare at all. Like, I didn't even like the fact that she was in the book.
Yeah, you know? It definitely like broke up the story a little bit, and it's almost like we were on one path of a story, and as soon as Grandmare, it's like we veered another direction of where I thought it could have gone.
Right, and I kind of want to see like. Were there other earlier drafts where maybe Grandmare wasn't in there? But yeah, I wasn't a fan of her. Now, I did like Eleanor's cousins, Reese and her sister Luma. Yeah. I thought, you know, it would have been nice to see a little bit more of that relationship developed, but, you know, then they were apart for so long. But it was kind of fun to see them because they do have moments of like just being teenagers.
Yeah, I agree with you. I think I'm someone who attaches myself very easily to secondary characters. And so I found that in Arthur. I wish I could have gotten a little bit more with particularly Reese, Luma as well. And then her other cousin, Charlie, I would have liked to see more of that relationship. Yeah. That was kind of hinted at, but we never really got to see.
Because we only see Charlie in like two scenes. One, mm-hmm. basically just kind of this flashback that keeps getting discussed. And then again, one time in the like current time period, which is another thing I think that added to the whole like creepy vibe was that we don't really know for sure when this happened.
Oh yeah, I had guesses. I had tried to map it out, and mm-hmm. I still don't know for sure what time, because there's no mention of really any technology other than a Model T vehicle.
Yeah,
that's it.
Yeah. You know, in my head, I kind of had it pictured in like maybe late 50s, early 60s, just because of that lack of technology. Like they don't even talk about a TV.
Yeah. And I was like, oh, it could be anywhere from the 1900s to the, 1960s.
Yeah.
It was such a broad range of like times it could have been. And it definitely gave me that feeling like I read this book and it was all in sepia.
Yeah, I know. And it wasn't sepia for me. It was more like black and white or like very faded color. Because we talked before how we read books and it's movies in our heads.
Definitely.
But yeah, I had like either very like faded kind of blurred color or black and white. And it kind of went back and forth. So I was like, okay, late 50s, early 60s. That's still feasible.
One thing that I really liked about the plot, at least, is this book, we're kind of like almost introduced in the middle of it. You know, mm-hmm. Eleanor, we don't really know much about her past. We don't know much about her family's past, neither does she. And so we're kind of like on this journey with her, like discovering the family. And that's like a lot of exposition. It could have been very, very boring. And I definitely think the way this book was written, as far as we get all these different ways of telling backstory. You know, there's a scene in which, you know, the grandfather is actually storytelling. Mm-hmm. We have the grandmother and her tarot cards, and we have, you know, a journal. I thought it was just really done well. It broke up the major line of the plot. And I definitely was more invested in learning about the family in their past more than probably the current day storyline.
Yeah, I would have really have liked to see more of like Miklos and Persephone's stories, her grandfather and grandmother, and to kind of see how they, you know, we get a little bit of how they came together, but really how they got to where they were in that town, you know. That was really nice. I did enjoy that too. And you get a font break too.
Oh.
So like when Persephone is kind of talking back and telling her story, I really appreciated the fact that there was a different font, like it italicized everything so that you knew, because there is that little bit of time where it kind of jumps back and forth. So I was like, okay, I really appreciated that. So thank you for that. Yeah, and with Eleanor, you know, she kind of struck me as an unreliable narrator. Mm-hmm. But I thought it was unique because she was unreliable, but she wasn't necessarily unlikable.
True.
Which I think a lot of times we see unreliable narrators as, you know, characters that we kind of don't care for.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, you definitely have moments of being like, you poor thing, you know. But, yeah, I just thought that was really neat, too. That is she a product of her environment? Is it her nature and this thing that she is? Or is she just, you know, a teenage girl on top of all these things?
Exactly. And I think I just would have liked to have seen more interactions and character growth from other characters. Like any scene that she was with Arthur, I found really intriguing. And I felt like
We
were learning a little bit more about her. She was more willing to be open with him about her past
mm-hmm.
and about her situation that caused her to leave abruptly from boarding school. And so I just wish we would have gotten more of those moments.
Yeah, I was definitely intrigued with her relationship with Arthur, because I think that even though they had, you know, we do find out that they had interacted some when she was a child before she went to boarding school. And I do think there was some like genuine affection there between them. But it would have been nice to see that a little bit more. But I also really was fascinated with Arthur's relationships with the rest of the family too. Like it was just
so much.
I know. It was just, and it was almost to the point of being ridiculous, but it was also mentioned that Arthur knew it.
Oh, for sure.
And he was just like very aware and was just like, okay.
And see, to me, that's the genius of this story, at least, mm-hmm. is because guess who we've talked about most in this book banter is Arthur.
I know.
We're kind of like, and, you know, kind of obsessed too.
We would not be mad if there was a book with just Arthur's story.
Just saying.
Just saying. I know. Yeah, he was definitely probably one of the better, like, secondary characters. I mean, he still kind of is a primary character, but he is still probably one of the better characters I've read.
Yeah.
Because he's in the story a lot, but I still want to know more. I need more of Arthur. So, yeah, I mean, other than that, my only other complaint was that I could definitely do with shorter chapters.
Oh, I feel that. I'm definitely a person who loves, like, short chapters, short, quick chapters. I mean, I'm even talking to the point of, like, one page or a couple of pages.
Yeah, but not 50.
Yeah, it felt kind of longer than I think it is. You know, this isn't a thick book. It's not short either, but the chapters definitely made the pacing slightly off for me as well.
Yeah, and that was, again, one of those things I went back and forth on where, yeah, I think it did kind of throw the pacing off a little bit, but at the same time, you know, it was with the whole vibe of the book where it was just, you know, like, what's happening? Oh, it's going to go this way. Nope. What are we doing now? Okay. No, you know, so yeah. All right. So yeah, we had a lot to say about this book and we could probably go on and on forever about it. But again, Amy and I read What Big Teeth by Rose Szabo. We do have copies available at our branches, and we also have the ebook on Libby/Overdrive and the e-audiobook on Hoopla. So thanks for joining us this time, and we'll see y'all next week. Bye.
Bye.